Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the latest in our Workplace Spotlight Series, EEO-1 Reporting Update. We're excited all of you could join us today. My name is Karen Rasmussen, and I'll be introducing our speakers and periodically jumping in to review some polls. We'll begin with a few housekeeping items, and then we'll get the presentation started. This is a live streaming event and is being recorded. We'll send you a link to the recording 24 hours after the webinar. To listen to the audio, please plug your headphones into your computer or smart device, or alternatively, make sure your speakers are turned up. While we will not be answering questions until the end of the webcast, time permitting, questions may be submitted anytime during the webcast by entering your question in the Q&A text field and clicking submit. I would also like to encourage you to complete our short survey by clicking on the checklist survey icon at the bottom of the screen. And a PDF of this presentation is available for download in the resource list next to the presentation slides. Today's webcast is certified for HRCI, SHRM, and CPE credit. For CPE credit, ADP partners with Wolters Kluwer for our CPE learning program. As a reminder, for those of you that want CPE credit, you will need to respond to all four polling questions throughout the session to qualify. And going to the link on the screen lets you manage all your courses and access your certificates. I would encourage you to download the presentation slides in the resource area as well, as we have a couple more slides at the end to serve as instruction on how to access certification. Lastly, before I introduce today's speakers, I just want to review our legal disclaimer. Today's presentation is not legal or tax advice. Before taking any actions on the information contained in this presentation, employers should review this material with their counsel. And keep in mind that what we are discussing today is not the final word on any of these topics. Regulations and legislation change, and employers need to comply with current laws. Also, nothing is intended to be a political opinion. ADP has over 60,000 employees and over 600,000 clients across the political spectrum. Our role is to assist employers with their compliance responsibilities. And with that, I'd like to introduce today's speakers, Ellen Feeney, Elena Almeida, and Megan Morey. Ellen specializes in healthcare reform, pay equity, the gig economy, and other emerging employer compliance issues. She provides compliance support related to several topics across ADP. She has extensive experience providing training and day-to-day advice on payroll, HR, and ACA compliance. She is a frequent speaker on workplace laws and how they affect employers of all sizes. Elena is an experienced corporate and employment litigation attorney with significant in-house and law firm expertise. Her current practice focuses on providing advice and counsel and training on hot topics in employment law, with a special interest in pay equity and workplace diversity issues. Megan is a management side lawyer with over a decade of nationwide experience. Prior to her role at counsel at ADP, she worked at an Am Law 100 law firm where she served as national outside counsel to a Fortune 15 corporation and two major financial institutions. Now, before I turn it over to Megan, I'd like to review our agenda and have our first polling question. So today, Megan and Ellen will discuss an overview of EEO-1 reporting changes and latest updates. All of our speakers will address answers to frequently asked questions and cover some scenarios that you may encounter, and Ellen's going to wrap up with a quick word on pay data and some final thoughts. So at this point, you should be seeing our first polling question on your screen. And our first question is, what is your level of familiarity with the new EEOC changes to include pay data and hours worked? Do you already have a plan in place? Have you started to investigate the impact? Are you aware but have not started to investigate the impact? Or are you not aware at all? So I'm going to give my first CPE reminder for those of you that would like CPE credit to please respond to the question to qualify. And I'm going to give you all several more seconds before I pass it to Megan to comment. Okay, Megan, at this point, you should be seeing the results on the screen, and I'll pass it to you.
Okay, great, Karen. I'm not seeing the results quite yet. Let's give it another second so we can see how everyone responded.
Sure, and I can tell you, too, because I see them. I can tell you almost 50%, that's probably the highest, are aware, but they have not yet started to investigate the impact. And then the next highest would be started to investigate the impact. But it looks like nearly half of our audience right now is aware of these changes, but have not yet started.
Okay. Well, I'm glad that everyone is aware, and I think that the slide that we're going to go through today will not just help you be aware, but help you actually prepare and execute your filing. So let's move into it. I'm going to start today with an overview of the EEOC changes and the latest updates. But first, let's talk very generally about Component 1 and Component 2 data. For those of you who are wondering, the Component 1 of the EEO form hasn't changed from prior years. It still asks for the number of employees who work for the business sorted by 10 job categories, race/ethnicity, and gender. And, of course, all private employers with 100 or more employees and federal contractors with 50 to 99 employees should have filed their Component 1 data information on May 31st, 2019. Now, what is Component 2 data? Well, Component 2 is the addition of pay data and hours worked to the, quote, traditional, unquote, Component 1 data. More specifically, it aggregates compensation data from Form W-2 Box 1, wages and hours worked data through the last pay period of the year organized by 10 EEO-1 job categories and 12 defined pay bands. Private employers, including federal contractors, with 100 or more employees must file this Component 2 report by September 30th, 2019. I'm going to turn now to the EEOC NORC action update. But first, I want to provide you with some additional background information. So, several months ago, the EEOC contracted with NORC, N-O-R-C, at the University of Chicago to collect the Component 2 data for 2017 and 2018. For those of you who are wondering, per their website, NORC at the University of Chicago is an objective, nonpartisan research institution that delivers reliable data and rigorous analysis to guide critical programmatic business and policy decisions. NORC and the EEOC have created a Component 2 website, which provides links to the filing login, facts, and other helpful info that we are going to be addressing in a few minutes. So, to start off, importantly, there are two options for employers to report their 2017 and 2018 pay and hours worked through the Component 2 EEO-1 filing system. The first option is to manually enter data info on an online form. On July 15th, as promised, the EEOC opened the portal for filing 2017 and 2018 EEO-1 Component 2 reports for those who manually enter data onto the online form. However, those filers who upload data through a bulk CSV file will have to wait until mid-August for that functionality to open up. Per the EEOC's most recent update, NORC is continuing to work on a data file upload function and validation process, which is expected to be available as an additional data collection method no later than August 15th, 2015. So please stay tuned and look for that functionality to open. In the meantime, the upload file specifications and upload verification process are available on the NORC website, so employers who are bulk filing can prepare in advance of the upload system availability. Additionally, I wanted to remind everyone that the help desk is open and fully operational. The contact information for the help desk is below. There's an email and toll-free number. And I will say the help desk is very, very busy, but so far they have been extremely responsive to questions and inquiries posed by filers. Finally, to file the report, you will need an ID. And on July 12, 2019, NORC mailed letters to employers with login information for the component to EEO-1 online filing portal. Just a few days later, on July 15th, NORC sent emails to employers with that login information. You should have received a USPS letter and email notification which includes your user ID needed to access the system. So please contact the help desk if you have not received the letter or email. So as I just mentioned, the EEOC NORC has created a website to assist users that is extremely helpful and continuously being updated. In fact, right before this webinar, we checked that website to make sure there were not any new updates. So if you go on the link here, https://eeoc.comp2.norc.org/index, you'll see the page on this slide. Updates and additional information are continuously being posted, so please check out this website and check it continually. So probably my most used part of this website are the FAQs. We will go over some of the key FAQs later in the presentation, but we encourage you to go look at these other FAQs as well. They are extremely helpful. In addition to the FAQ section, there is a very robust More Info section. Under the More Info tab, there's a host of useful information, including specifications for the bulk filing method I mentioned earlier. Also under that tab are sample forms, instruction booklet for filers, user's guide, fact sheet, and reference documents to support your filing. We will go over the form shortly, but we encourage you to check out the other information under this tab. So, as I mentioned a few minutes ago, for those employers using the CFV and bulk batch reporting process, the EEOC NORC has provided the upload file specifications and upload file validation process so you can prepare in advance of the upload system availability. Again, we expect that portion of the filing system to be open on August 15th, but in the interim, please look at the technical specifications if you are a bulk filer so that you can be prepared to file at that time. Now, we're going to switch gears a little bit, and I'm going to turn over the presentation to my colleague, Ellen. Ellen, take it away.
Great. Thanks a lot, Megan. Also, the FAQ section on the EEOC NORC website is also, you know, one of my favorite sections just because it contains so much information. And it's good to know that the EEOC has posted so many resources on their website because we were really in a holding pattern for the EOC to issue new information. We've needed more specific information on this new requirement, and it's good that now we have it, as well as, you know, the outlet of being able to call a help desk to get clarification, if an employer needs it. So I'm now going to take us on a deeper dive of the Component 2 form and what has specifically changed. Before I get into it, however, this slide reviews the Component 1 requirement. Component 1 data for 2018 was due on May 31st, 2019. So hopefully, if you are an EEO-1 filer who needed to file, you have completed that. Component 1 has been in place for many, many years, and but now, this slide shows kind of the rest of the requirements for Component 1, which you should be familiar with. Selecting a snapshot period between October 1st and December 31st, counting the number of full-time, part-time, and variable hour workers employed by your establishment during the snapshot period, and also breaking out the employee count into mutually exclusive categories. Each employee is assigned to one of 10 separate EEO-1 job categories and one of 14 separate categories based on race, ethnicity, and gender. This is what, you know, we've been used to. So before I move on, though, just, you know, on the bottom of this slide, a quick note about confidentiality. Individual EEO-1 submissions are kept confidential, but may be publicly disclosed by employers as evidence of good citizenship. You sometimes will see an employer post their EEO-1 filing on their website and have it available. The EEO-1 report may be disclosed by the agency pursuant to FOIA requests submitted to the OFCCP by federal contractors. So many employers have expressed confidentiality concerns with the addition of pay data, but the EOC also addresses this on the material in their website. So if you have confidentiality concerns, you should definitely check out, directly from the source at the EOC what they're saying about that. So before we get into what has changed, let's consider what has not changed with Component 2. The 10 EEO-1 job categories have not changed, as you can see on the left-hand side of the screen here. Also, if you have done EEO-1 reporting in the past, you'll be familiar with these 10 job categories. Also, the race and ethnicity groups remain the same. Employers are put into categories of Hispanic or Latino or non-Hispanic or Latino and further split by white, black, or African American, Native Hawaiian, or other Pacific Islander, Asian, American Indian, Alaska Native, two or more races. And you should be familiar, with all of that as well. So once again, the race and ethnicity groups have not changed. So what are the changes? Component 2 is due September 30th, 2019, and so employers must now report pay and hours worked data for employees. And pay is determined by looking at Box 1 W-2 wages, and specific rules, which we'll review, cover hours worked data. Employers take a snapshot pay period from any single pay period between October 1st to December 31st. And also remember, you're reporting data for 2017 and 2018 by December 30th. 2 years worth of data, one filing date. You'll hear me say it again, just because that's new. Keep that in mind. So year-end pay data is used for each employee to be further classified into one of 12 separate pay bands within each job category. And these 12 pay bands are defined by the EOC and are listed here on the right-hand side of this slide. And this is new, these EOC-defined pay bands. Hours work data are aggregated and summarized for each pay, jobs, ethnicity category to normalize wage rates between full-time and part-time employees. And for the reporting due on September 30th, data is summarized for the end of the calendar year for both 2017 and 2018. You know, I'll say it again, 2 years worth of data, one filing date. So here's a comparison of component one and component two. Component one has the 10 distinct rows for the 10 EEO-1 job categories. We already reviewed how these have not changed. Component one also has 14 distinct columns covering sex plus race and ethnicity groups. There's additional rows on component one, additional rows and columns for subtotals, and employee counts are entered into each matrix cell. Compare this to component two. Component two has 120 rows, the 10 job categories that are each broken into 12 separate pay bands. The matrix is completed twice, first with employee counts and secondly with total hours worked. And we'll take a closer look at that so you can see, exactly, what the EEOC wants you to do. Let's take a closer look at how the additional pay data breakout works. You'll have the same job categories as listed on the component one, but with the additional pay band breakout, as you can see here. And here I'm just showing it partially for executives, senior level officials, and managers. But that pay band breakout will be repeated under each job category. So you can see how that really, increases the content, the amount of data that needs to be, filled out on the component two form. Let's take a look at exactly how this will work on the component two form. So employers, are asking a question that's also covered in the frequently asked questions, is employers are asking how will data about employee sex and race or ethnicity be reported on the EEO-1 component two? And the answer is that after tallying the total number of employees in each compensation band by job category, employers will enter this data in the appropriate columns of the EEO-1 report based on the sex and ethnicity or race of the employee. And this sample form that you see here on this slide, illustrates how the component to EEO-1 online filing system is organized to collect compensation data for employers with 100 or more employees. If employers have multiple establishments, this compensation data form needs to be completed for the employer in total, the headquarters and each establishment with more than 50 employees. When an employer has establishments with 50 or fewer employees, the employer may choose to report compensation data in this detailed form or report establishments with 50 or fewer employees in a list format. Employers are required to report on all full-time and part-time employees working during the workforce snapshot period. And compensation data includes the number of employees and the hours worked by gender, race, ethnicity, job category, and salary. In the EEOC's, this component to online filing system, blank cells in the form will be considered as zeros. But the instruction booklet, fact sheet, and FAQs provide additional information regarding the reporting requirements, including, technical specifications. The EEOC here is looking for number of employees. For example, if you have three Hispanic employees in your workforce who are in the job category of executive and they each earn $50,000, you would list three under Hispanic or Latino, column B for female in the row with the pay band six. And that's, that $50,000, falls in that pay band of $49,920 to $62,919. So how do you come up with the employee count? The employee's pay data is taken directly from year-end W-2 box 1. It's then mapped into one of the 12 pay bands. An employee identifier is used to link back to your HR system of record, and you can do this manually or check with your payroll HR service provider. ADP is updating its systems, so if you're a current client who has EEO-1 reporting available as part of your current ADP services, updates are being made to the EEO-1 functionality, and so you should be receiving or have already received information from your service team. Let's look at now how hours worked will be reported. This is the second matrix that makes up the component to filing. So how are hours calculated? For non-exempt employees, hours worked are determined by the actual time record. The definition of hours worked is consistent with the FLSA, and this makes sense since under the FLSA for your non-exempt employees, you're supposed to be tracking actual hours worked. For exempt employees, you have two options. You can use the actual hours if you record them, or you can use an EEOC-provided proxy of 40 hours for full-time and 20 hours for part-time. Annual work hours are aggregated for all employees in the snapshot period. So what hours must be provided? As mentioned, Component 2 has a second matrix, which you see on the screen here, to report the hours worked data, and each cell on the hours worked matrix corresponds to a cell on the summary compensation data matrix. The hours worked during that year by all the employees are counted in the cell on the summary compensation data matrix, and then they're totaled and then recorded in the corresponding cell on the hours worked matrix. So some questions that employers have are hours worked by part-time employees, do they get reported on component 2? Yes. Hours worked data are reported to account for part-time and partial year employment. There are questions about, which employees are the hours aggregated for? Is it just employees who worked during the workforce snapshot period, or is it all employees who worked for the employer at any time during the EEO-1 reporting year? For example, employees who terminated before the workforce snapshot period, who were hired after the workforce snapshot period. So in that situation, the aggregated hours worked should only be reported for those employees who worked during the selected workforce snapshot period. You always come back to the workforce snapshot period. The aggregated hours will not include the hours worked by any employees who were terminated before the selected workforce snapshot period, and it also won't include the hours worked by employees who were hired after the selected workforce snapshot period. Now, Karen, back to you to cover our next polling question.
Thank you so much, Ellen. So at this point, we are going to have our second polling question. Oh, excuse me. For some reason, I went to the results. Hold on just one sec. Okay. So at this point, you should be seeing the polling question on your screen. Our second question is, how confident are you that your company will be able to comply with the new EEO-1 mandate by the deadline? And your options are, you are very confident that your company will be able to, you are somewhat confident, you are not confident, or you don't know if your company will be able to comply. And if for some reason you're not seeing the polling question, you can always respond in the Q&A field and we'll record it for you. I'm going to give you all a few more seconds to respond. And then, Elena, I think I pass it to you to comment on the results.
Sure.
I'm going to give a couple more seconds. Okay, Elena, you should see the results now. If not, I can read them for you.
No, I see them, Karen. Thank you very much. It looks like 39% about feel very confident that they'll be able to comply with the new EEO-1 mandate by the deadline, and another 46% feel somewhat confident about that. And those are great numbers, and I know we're giving you a lot of information in this presentation, and we figured we'd spend the rest of our time kind of focusing on specific questions and scenarios that might help improve those confidence numbers even more. There's a lot of questions that we've received and that the EEOC has been answering, and they kind of fall into general categories. So there's a lot of questions, and as I've been scanning the, as Ellen and Megan have been talking, I was scanning the Q&A for questions that have been submitted during this presentation. And I've noticed that the questions that you have fall generally into these categories. We have filing requirements, you know, do I have to file? Because my company is, you know, a small company. How to handle the workforce snapshot period? And are you committed to the workforce snapshot decisions that you made when filing component one reports for 2017 and 2018? We also have questions about summary compensation, hours worked, as well as some multi-establishment reporting and questions relating to companies that have gone through acquisitions or mergers or spinoffs in this period of time. One thing I would like to say about the multi-establishment reporting and the acquisitions, mergers, and spinoffs, we are covering a couple of issues related to those in this, but I encourage you to look at the EEOC NORC website and the frequently asked questions there, because they have a lot more detailed FAQs dealing with the unique circumstances of companies who are in that situation. So first, we'll talk a little bit more about the filing requirements. So who does Component 2 apply to? Which companies are required to submit a Component 2 report? So employers, including federal contractors, are required to submit Component 2 compensation data for the years 2017 and 2018 if they have 100 or more employees during the 2017 and 2018 workforce snapshot period. This one thing I want to point out here is that the group of employers that are required to file Component 2 is slightly smaller than that is required to file Component 1. For Component 1, companies who, private employers with 100 or more employees and federal contractors with 50 to 99 employees were required to file for Component 1. For Component 2, only those employers, including federal contractors, who have 100 or more employees during the workforce snapshot period are required to file the report. So federal contractors with 50 to 99 employees had to file a Component 1 report, but do not have to file the Component 2 report. The workforce snapshot period has also prompted a lot of questions, because it does have a significant, it can have a significant impact on each company's filing. The date, which date should be used to determine the 100 employee filing requirement for each reporting year? So as Ellen said earlier, to determine if you meet the 100 employee threshold for 2017 or 2018, employers should count the number of employees during the workforce snapshot period for that reporting year. But employers can choose whichever workforce snapshot period it wants to, between October 1 and December 31 of the reporting year. If an employee is on board during the selected workforce snapshot period, for example, if I pick the first 2 weeks of October as my snapshot period, and there's an employee, a full or part-time employee, that employee is going to be counted in your Component 2 filing. If you choose a payroll period, then
all of the employees on the payroll during that workforce snapshot period are counted, even if those employees resign or are terminated before the end of the year. As we discussed earlier, the employer only reports on the full and part-time employers on the payroll during the workforce snapshot period. It's the total universe of employees the employer should include in component two of the EEO-1. But for some companies, the choice of a workforce snapshot period could be very significant. For example, what if an employer's workforce levels fluctuate above and below 100 employees in October through December because of some seasonal hiring? If the employer chooses a workforce snapshot period between October 1 and December 31, in which they have less than 100 employees, they don't have to file a component two. Just because there are other workforce snapshot periods that the employer could have chosen between October 1 and December 31 that had more than 100 employees, the EEO said the employer is not obligated to pick that, and the EEOC has stated the employer does not have to choose a pay period when it has 100 or more employees. Another frequently asked question about the workforce snapshot period is the interplay between the employer's Component 1 and Component 2 filings. Component 1 filings also rely on a workforce snapshot period, and employers have already filed their 2017 and 2018 Component 1 reports, and they already chose a workforce snapshot period for those 2017 and 2018 Component 1 filings. So does an employer have to choose the same workforce snapshot period for Component 2 that it chose for Component 1 EEO reporting for those reporting years? The EEOC has been clear that no, employers are permitted to choose a different workforce snapshot period for reporting Component 2 data for each of those years if they so choose. You are not committed to the same workforce snapshot period that you chose when you're filing your Component 1 reports. So we have wanted to go through a few questions that we regularly get about compensation and the measure of compensation that employers should use in order to select the appropriate compensation or pay band. As Ellen mentioned earlier, employers use the W-2 Box 1 income figure calculated for end-of-year tax reporting purposes. W-2 Box 1 income is the measure of compensation that includes total taxable wages, tips, and other compensation that you pay to your employee during the calendar year, as instructed by the IRS. Using the W-2 Box 1 income, you can determine which of the pay bands Ellen referenced earlier. So which of the pay bands a particular employee fits into. Many employers have asked whether employers can reference gross annual earnings instead of W-2 Box 1 earnings for Component 2. The clear answer is no. The EEOC said that employers must report compensation based on W-2 Box 1 earnings for Component 2 data. So let's look at a scenario that many of you may have to deal with. Suppose an employee, Joey, was hired on July 1st and worked the rest of the calendar year through December 31st. His salary is $100,000 per year, but his W-2 Box 1 only reports $50,000. Because Joey started with the company in July, mid-year. So Ellen, help us out. In what compensation band should Joey be reported? The one that covers $100,000 or the one that covers $50,000?
Yeah, so thanks, Elena. So employers should not calculate and then report the annualized earnings for employees who did not work the full calendar year like Joey here. Employers should use the information found in Box 1 under employees' W-2s to assign the employees to the relevant Component 2 salary bands. So in this scenario, Joey's employer should report the July to December
employee in the compensation band, the salary band that corresponds with $50,000, which is the number on his W-2, in box one. Here's another question on the topic of summary compensation data. So what about corrections to wage data? So how should employers handle reporting of W-2 wage data corrections? So, think of your, W-2Cs that you have every year. Should employers report the year-end W-2 box one wage amounts that were, originally issued, or should employers attempt to report subsequent corrected amounts? And here the EOC has said employers can choose to report subsequent corrected W-2 box one amounts if they so choose, but employers are also permitted to choose the W-2 box one wage amounts they originally issued for either 2017 or 2018. So that's actually helpful that you don't have to, dig out your W-2Cs, that you can rely on the original W-2s that were filed for the calendar year. All right, now it's time for another scenario. This also has to do with, reporting on, pay data. So how should companies report employees who start out at a U.S. location, then transfer to an overseas location during the year in a different FEIN for a portion of the year, but then they transfer back to the a U.S. location? Should employers include or exclude their earnings while the employee is overseas? So, Elena, what should an employer do in this situation?
Again, thank you, Ellen. Employers should stick to the W-2 box one earnings for any employee who was at a U.S. location during the selected workforce snapshot period. The employers don't have to adjust those earnings in any way to compensate for time abroad. I'd love now to turn to one of the more complicated, but in my opinion, interesting issues that employers are grappling with: hours worked and FLSA status. So here's a scenario. Chloe is an FLSA exempt employee, and her employer does not track her actual hours worked. Of course, hours worked is part of the component to report. How should Chloe's employer report her hours when preparing its component to filing? Ellen?
Thanks, Elena. So here, for FLSA exempt employees like Chloe, if the employer doesn't track actual hours worked, the employer must report a proxy of 40 hours per week for full-time exempt employees and 20 hours per week for part-time exempt employees, multiplied by the number of weeks the employees were employed during the EEO-1 component to reporting year. And so this is, I find, generates, most of the questions we see dealing with, just how to report hours worked for exempt, for non-exempt. And so, this is important information, to keep in mind, because you're dealing with EEOC, supplied proxies. So, Elena, back to you now.
Ellen, you're not getting away with this so easily. So we understand that the there's a proxy set by the EEOC of 40 hours per week for full-time exempt employees and 20 hours per week for part-time exempt employees. But what if Chloe's employer requires exempt employees to track their actual hours worked and maintains accurate time records? We're going to try a polling question to see how people think that Chloe's employer should track Chloe's hours in that situation.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. So at this point, you all should be seeing the third polling question on your screen, and it is to answer Chloe's scenario, so you have a couple options. So what if Chloe's employer requires exempt employees to track their actual hours worked and maintains accurate time records? How should her company report her hours worked for Component 2? Should they report actual hours worked by the exempt employee? Should they use the proxy hours, which are 40 hours per week for full-time exempt employees and 20 hours per week for part-time exempt employees? Or can they do either of the above? And I'm going to give my third reminder for those of you that want CPE credit to please make sure you respond to the question to qualify. Give you all just a couple more seconds. Megan, I think I passed this one to you in just a few seconds.
Yes, you do. I'm anxiously awaiting our poll results.
All right, let's see. Okay, Megan, you should be seeing them now. If not, just let me know and I'll read them to you.
Okay, great. So about 40% of you reported number one. About 18% picked the second option, and 42% picked the third option. Well, these are all excellent responses, but if you picked the third option, you were correct. For FLSA exempt employees, employers have the option to either report actual hours worked by the exempt employee if the employer already maintains accurate records of this information, or report a proxy of 40 hours per week for full-time exempt employees and 20 hours per week for part-time exempt employees multiplied by the number of weeks the employees were employed during the EEO-1 Component 2 reporting year. So basically, if you're an employer that tracks and maintains the records of your exempt employees' time, you can choose either option here. A trick question, but I'm proud to say 42% of you got the answer right. And those who picked other options still had the right answer. You could still report that way, but three is the correct answer. So good job to everyone. Moving along to another frequently asked question for hours worked. Will employers have to report the hours worked or hours paid for Component 2? In other words, should employers count hours for paid time off, paid sick leave, paid holidays, etc.? I'm glad that we put this question and answer in here because as I was scrolling through the questions, a lot of you had this question. And the answer is the hours work data that employers will report for the EEO-1 Component 2 will be based on the same hours that employers record for FLSA purposes. And FLSA hours work generally do not include paid leave, such as sick leave, vacation leave, or paid holidays. And moving along to a different topic, multi-establishment recording. And I think we've mentioned this a couple of times during today's webinar, but there are numerous FAQs about multi-established reporting on the website. We're only hitting a highlight here, but please, if you have additional questions, check out that FAQ on the website. So the question here, if an employer has multiple establishments and some of the establishments have fewer than 100 employees, does the employer only report EEO-1 Component 2 data for establishments with more than 100 employees? No. An employer reports EEO-1 Component 2 data for all its establishments, including those with fewer than 100 employees. The 100 employee threshold is for the employer as a whole, after totaling employees based at headquarters and all locations or establishments. Another hot topic today, acquisitions, mergers, and spin-offs. Again, the FAQ section on the website has a robust section on acquisitions, mergers, and spin-offs. If you and your organization have engaged in M&A activity this year, we encourage you to take a look at those FAQs. But right now, we're just going to go through one scenario. So here's the scenario. We acquired a company and merged it fully into our current company. The person who completed the 2017 Component 1 report of the acquired company is not employed by our current company, and we cannot locate the file that was used for the 2017 Component 1 report. How should this company report Component 2 data when all or part of that data is not available? Good question. What is the answer? Well, in situations where a company experienced an acquisition or merger and does not have access to the Component 2 data from the acquired or former company, employers should note this in the comments box on the certification section in the Component 2 EEO-1 online filing system. And I'm very happy that the EEO-1 did address this question and questions similar to it to the M&A in the M&A section, because we have been getting a lot of questions about entities that have merged that do not have historical data of acquired entities. If you don't have that data, you simply need to note it in the comment box. A big relief for employers. And with that said, I'm going to turn it over to Karen to introduce our final topic of the day.
Thank you so much, Megan. So yes, before I pass it to Ellen, she is going to talk about a quick word on pay data and audits. I am going to do our last polling question for the session. And at this point, you should hopefully be seeing the question, the polling question on your screen. And it is pay equity a topic of conversation among your key executives? This is easy answers. Yes, it is a topic of conversation. No, it is not a topic of conversation, or you are unsure that it's a topic of conversation. I'm going to give you all several seconds to respond. I know we have a lot of you online today before I pass it to Ellen. Okay, Ellen, you should be seeing the results on the screen. If not, just let me know.
Yes, thanks, Karen. So, taking a look at this result, 42% of you are saying, pay equity is a topic of conversation among your key executives. 26% of you are saying no, and 32% of you are unsure. And, that may be based on your role. One thing for certain, though, that we recently saw, with the U.S. women's soccer team, capturing the World Cup, pay equity and equal pay is definitely part of our national conversation. And a lot of companies are also, addressing pay equity in their workplace. And it may not be happening. There may not necessarily be employee communication about it because of the sensitive nature of the topic, or because a lot of times pay equity audits are conducted under attorney-client privilege. But we thought it was important to, spend a few minutes here at the end, talking about pay equity audits. And so, EEO-1 Component 2, that we're all scrambling to comply with, isn't a substitute for a pay equity audit. And, today we reviewed in detail the Component 2, focused on the addition of hours worked and pay data, and the EEOC is going to use that to do some, pay equity analysis. But Component 2 data only takes you so far, and for your organization, doesn't represent a true pay equity
audit that would consider all kinds of pay data, not just W-2 box one wages. And so we include here, you know, we list some reasons for, you know, why it's important for organizations to conduct a pay equity audit. That, you know, it's important for all organizations today to understand their pay structure. It's also important to do a pay equity audit to reduce potential liability. You know, you want to consider federal, state, and local requirements. And it's not just, you know, complying with equal pay laws, but also, you know, some states have started to include an affirmative defense, you know, for employers who proactively do a pay equity audit and take steps to address, you know, any pay disparities. You know, it's helpful also to identify potential gender pay differences based on internal data. By doing an audit, you can determine whether differences are statistically significant. It gives you an opportunity to explain differences. You know, it's helpful to be proactive in this area and not wait until you're, you know, hit with a lawsuit or a complaint. And then if necessary, you can take steps to, you know, implement pay adjustments to address pay gaps. You know, pay differences can be an issue. It's not just starting pay. It also could be merit raises or other forms of compensation, bonus compensation, you know, shares of equity. You know, you could be clean in one area but have an issue in another area. So it's important really to take a comprehensive look at your compensation practices across the board. You know, a lot of information is required to do a proper pay equity audit, and it's essential for your data to be complete and accurate. You know, some people will consider, you know, having a push or a mandate to fill in HRIS system fields more than is necessary to run payroll. You know, sometimes, you know, people will just have in their system exactly what they need to run payroll. You need to balance this, though, with privacy concerns. You generally only want to collect the data needed to run, you know, payroll, administer benefits, or take care of HR tasks. But, you know, realize that a pay equity audit requires many types of data. And so you want to have a good idea of, you know, where you're keeping this data. So some final thoughts. Today, you know, September 30th is rapidly approaching, and you should be preparing if you need to file. Remember, 2 years worth of data for 2017 and 2018, one filing date. Use all available resources. Refer back to this presentation. Definitely refer to the EEOC and NORC website. There's lots of great resources there to take advantage of, you know, including a help desk that will answer questions for you. And also, you know, consider doing your own pay equity audit, but definitely plan properly for that and consult with your, you know, counsel. So Karen, it's now time to wrap up.
Thank you so much, Ellen and Elena and Megan, for all that information. I know is a lot to cover today, and I appreciate everyone staying on for the hour. So, but unfortunately, based on timing, this does conclude our event for today. Your HRCI and SHRM credit information will be included in the thank you for attending email. And if you requested CPE credit when you registered, you should be able to access your CPE credit using the instructions in the presentation within 24 to 48 hours. And if you would like to receive ongoing communications from ADP on regulatory and legislative guidelines and deadlines, such as EEOC and other updates as well, please subscribe to our Eye on Washington email alerts by visiting the link shown on the screen or indicate you'd like to opt in the event survey. And for more workforce trends and insights, we encourage you to visit our ADP blog link shown on the screen. And we also encourage you to register for additional workplace spotlight webinars, such as our next event on August 22nd on wage and hour compliance updates, changing the rules of the game using the link shown on the screen. So on behalf of Ellen, Elena, Megan, myself, and the entire team at ABP, we thank you for joining us today and look forward to having you join us for future Workplace Spotlight events. Thank you and have a great day.